Hello, and good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you're joining us from. Welcome to Engineering for Change, or E4C for short. Today, we're very pleased to bring you the latest E4C webinar. Today's webinar was developed in collaboration with Alexander Pan of the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs and Mike Han from Synergy. My name is Paul Scott, and I'll be moderating today's webinar. And when I'm not doing this, I actually work within ASME's Engineering for Global Development group as the program manager for an initiative that's focused on hardware-led social ventures. I'd like to take a moment now to tell you a little bit about today's webinar. Impact Inventing, Strengthening the Ecosystem for Invention-Based Entrepreneurship in Emerging Economies. Hardware-based ventures, or impact inventing, are at the heart of Engineering for Global Development, and at E4C we're focused on collecting and sharing information about the challenges in development and deployment of technology-based solutions, as well as potential new innovations and supporting structures to scale products. As part of this effort, we've invited experts in the field to join us today and share their thoughts. As mentioned, we've got Alexander Pan, who's the program coordinator of the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs, and Mike Han from Synergy. Mike's a product development manager at Synergy, and Synergy's a social venture based in Kenya. We'd like to thank you for joining us today. Before we get rolling, I'd also like to take a moment to recognize the coordinators of the E4C webinar series. Jana Aranda of ASME, Holly Scheider-Brown, Michael Mader and Steve Walsh of IEEE, and the rest of the team. Thanks for your help. If you've got any recommendations for future topics or speakers, we invite you to contact the team via their email addresses visible on the slide, webinars@engineeringforchange.org. Before we move on to our presenters, I just wanted to give you a quick reminder of what Engineering for Change is all about. E4C is a global community of over 770,000 people, such as engineers, technologists, development practitioners from NGOs, and social scientists, who work together to solve humanitarian challenges faced by underserved communities around the world, such as access to water, off-grid energy, effective healthcare, agriculture, sanitation, and others. We invite you to join the E4C for community by becoming a member. E4C membership provides cost-free access to a growing inventory of field-tested solutions and related information from our members, including professional societies like ASME, IEEE, ANDE, and EWB USA. Registration is easy and free. Check out our website at www.engineeringforchange.org to sign up for more information. The webinar you're participating in today is one installment of the Engineering for Change webinar series. It's a free, publicly available series of online seminars to showcase best practice and thinking of leaders in the field. You can also watch them on demand at engineeringforchangewebinars.org. And if you're following us on Twitter, we'd like to invite you to join the conversation with our dedicated hashtag E4C webinars. Just to let you know about the next E4C webinar, it's going to be on December 10th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and it's going to be, the title is Simple but Intelligent Solutions for People with Health Restrictions, and we'll have someone from Siemens Schuftung joining us for that. A few housekeeping items before we get started. On the screen you're now seeing, there are a number of different widgets on the dashboard at the bottom. The group chat is where you will interact with your fellow attendees and post any comments about the webinar. The Q&A widget allows you to submit any questions for the presenter. The help widget is for inquiries about technical difficulties. And share this allows you to share the link of this webcast with your friends and colleagues. You can do this on Twitter and other social media sites. Lastly, there's the survey icon that allows you to take a survey at any time about the webinar. We've got quite a few people from around the world on the webinar today. Even the presenters I know are in Canada, on the west coast of the US, and in Washington, D.C. So it'd be really good to understand where we've got some of our participants from. So using your group chat, please type in your location, and then we can see whereabouts in the world you're joining us from. I see we've got people from the US joining us. We've got a few people from India, someone from Peru, a participant from Los Angeles, and someone from London, amongst other places. Thanks very much for letting us know where you're joining from, and it's good to see we've got participation from all around the world. So let's talk a little bit about today's presenters. We've got Alexander Pan, and he's the program coordinator at the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs. For those of you that don't know ANDE, they're a network of small and growing businesses around the world, and they provide support to the ecosystem. We also have Mike Han, who's a product developer at Synergy. And as I mentioned, Synergy is a social venture based in Nairobi in Kenya. So let's get on to the topic of the day. And I'm just going to give a little bit of framing of the discussions that will follow today. So we're here to talk about invention. We're here to talk about engineering. And we're here to talk about hardware and products. And why is that important? Well, in recent times, there's been a tremendous focus on the role of social ventures contributing to global development challenges. The challenge is that when it's done through product-based ventures or hardware or invention, it seems to be very difficult to get these ventures to scale. And so we're interested in looking at the concepts of this and understanding what actually it takes to get hardware-based ventures to scale or invention-based businesses to scale. There's much more complexity, it's much more interdisciplinary than other types of ventures trying to get to scale. So that's what we're here to talk about today. If we look at the different routes to market for an organization, you can break them down into a technology journey, a company journey, a finance journey, a market journey, and a policy and regulation journey. And any social venture has to navigate these journeys in order to take their product to market. And it's particularly difficult when you're looking at a product-based venture or an invention-based venture, because the complexity of making all those things come to fruition and take them to market at scale is particularly challenging. So that's what we're interested in exploring today and gaining insights from the series of roundtables and the publication that the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs has done, but then also gaining insights from the ground from an actual product developer who's out there day to day doing this type of work in the field. Just to think about the role of the engineering in this, it's interesting to think a little bit about the different questions that are in an engineer's toolkit or a science and technology professional's toolkit to understand how to develop and deploy a product to market. And these are some of the questions that perhaps you may ask yourselves if you're thinking about taking products to market. So with that said, I'll pass it over to Alexander Pan of the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs to take us through his recent publication on impact inventing. Alex, thanks very much for joining us today, and over to you.
No problem, Paul. Thanks for having me, and thanks for the introduction. And I also wanted to take just a second and thank the whole ASME and E4C team for inviting me to present today. As Paul said, I'm from the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs, and I'll take a brief second and kind of explain what ANDE is, as our acronym is known as. So we are a global network of organizations that work to support small and growing businesses in the developing world. And we use the term small and growing businesses rather than the more traditionally known term of small and medium-sized enterprises, because we're really focusing on the small size of small side of small and medium. Businesses that employ between 5 and 250 employees and are seeking growth capital. of between $20,000 and $2 million. And the reason why we're focusing on this particular size is, one, because we think that there's a missing middle there. You know, if you're a micro enterprise, you can probably access microfinance and a variety of other supports. And then if you're a medium-sized enterprise, you can more readily access traditional finance through banks and other commercial capital. But in this middle is really a gap where no one really wants to invest in or support the growth of these small businesses. But we think that's really important because by helping these small and growing businesses or SGBs scale, we can create social impact in lots of different ways. So we think that the growth of these enterprises creates jobs. So that's social impact in itself. But also a lot of these small and growing businesses serve a social purpose, or they're trying to deliver goods and services to underserved markets. And so we think that by supporting these small and growing businesses, we can help alleviate poverty in the developing world. So ANDE functions as a membership organization, and we have members that represent the whole kind of ecosystem that supports these small and growing businesses. So these include primarily capacity development providers, so these are incubators and accelerators and the like. Also investors, a range of different kinds of investors, from your finance-first commercial investors to more impact and social-oriented investments. But then we also have a range of other actors, such as corporations, foundations, academic institutions, research and consultants, and as well as some DFIs and donor agencies. And this network is really global in its scope. So we have members all over the world and regional chapters in Mexico, Brazil, South Africa, Kenya, and India. And we also have kind of emerging chapters in West Africa and East and Southeast Asia as well. So in sum, the Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs is a network of intermediaries that supports small and growing businesses. So we got into this invention space or technology-based entrepreneurship because we noticed that our members that were trying to support invention-based entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs that are trying to develop and commercialize new technology-based products were facing a particular set of challenges and that they were finding supporting these types of ventures more difficult than supporting the kind of more traditional service-oriented entrepreneurs that they were used to. So we wanted to understand what makes these entrepreneurs unique, but also, you know, how can the ecosystem that ANDE represents identify what gaps there are in this ecosystem, and how can we work collaboratively to fill those gaps? So what we did is we convened a series of global roundtables with the help of the Lemelson Foundation and Paul at ASME. And we held these roundtables in Brazil, India, Kenya, South Africa, and one in Santa Clara, California. And so we had over 110 participants from over 90 organizations. And we held these roundtables to explore exactly the gaps in the ecosystem, the challenges that invention-based entrepreneurs face, and what we can do and how we can work together to better address those challenges. And just to put this into a bit of context, and I think Paul did a really good job of introducing this, but you know, we've seen this growing focus on social entrepreneurship and small and growing businesses as viable global development solutions. There's been a shift in the aid community that has recognized that supporting businesses with social missions can really deliver social impact. At the same time, we have this shift recognizing that science, technology, and innovation can really have a positive impact on the lives of people living at the bottom of the economic pyramid, and that we can really utilize the power of science and technology to improve those people's lives. And then we also have some shifting kind of macroeconomic trends that have allowed small firms to really be drivers of innovation and has taken away some of the competitive advantages traditionally seen by large enterprises. Not to say that they don't still have an advantage, but we've seen small firms be able to really be drivers of innovation, particularly in BOP markets. So all these factors kind of combined to create this opportunity for invention-based businesses to create sustainable, scalable, and technology-based solutions for poverty. Let me just wait for the slide to advance. So I think Paul kind of covered this, but quickly I just wanted to define my terms. So when we're talking about invention-based entrepreneurship, we're talking about a subset of technology-based entrepreneurs that are really developing new physical technology-based products for those living at the base of the pyramid. And so we use this term to differentiate it hardware-based enterprises or people developing products from software or ICT-based technologies for the bottom of the pyramid. Not because we don't think that ICT is important, but because we think there's unique challenges associated with building things, physical products, and we wanted to explore how to support those enterprises. And there seems to be a lot going on in the ICT space, but not quite as much investigation into the hardware space. And we're taking what we call an ecosystem approach. And I don't know if you can really read this slide. But basically, we believe that an entrepreneur's ability to succeed or their likelihood of succeeding is largely determined by the environment in which they're operating in. So we think that entrepreneurs need support from a variety of different sources and to accomplish a variety of different goals. So they need capacity development support, they need access to finance, they need access to talent. So they really need to be engaging in the ecosystem. But what we found was that there's several important gaps in the ecosystem for invention-based entrepreneurs. And those are particularly can be categorized into five larger gaps. So this is the market gap, and the finance gap, the talent gap, the policy gap, and the physical capital gap. So I'll be going through each of those briefly, and then we can take your questions at the end if you want more details into any of those particular areas. So when we're talking about markets, developing a product is great, but in order for that product to create social impact, people actually need to one, acquire the product, and two, use the product. And unfortunately, we're seeing that doesn't happen as often as we would like. And this happens for a variety of reasons. First and foremost, there's a design disconnect. A lot of these technologies are being developed in Western universities, either by grad students or researchers, that really don't have a great sense of the needs and the abilities of the target population that they're aiming to serve. So there's really a need to better understand the populations that products are designed to serve, and we think that the ecosystem can better support this by kind of encouraging and teaching human-centered design practices. So ANDE members like IDEO.org or Catapult are really working in this space to increase better design and better connection with the target markets. We also found that the people aren't collecting consumer feedback well. In order to develop a good product, it has to go through several product iterations. So you need to test these products with the populations that you're aiming to serve and collect their feedback, see how they like it or don't like it, and then make the necessary design modifications. But this process can be very, very expensive, especially in the remote markets that when we're talking about impact technologies, these are hard to reach places. So this process can be very expensive and very time consuming. Well, there's a lot of emerging either technologies or best practices that are designed to streamline this process and make it more efficient. So, for example, Vilgro incubator out of India is working to develop a mobile phone voice survey that can help collect feedback from populations on products. So we need to explore how to support that better. Consumer financing also is also very important. You know, you can design products to be affordable, but oftentimes when you're talking about populations that live on less than $2 a day, it's very hard to make products affordable enough. But there's a lot of innovative kind of business plans or technologies that you can utilize to make these products affordable to even the poorest of the poor. Pay-as-you-go technologies are really interesting and can de-risk the risk of purchasing products. And also there's a lot of interesting partnerships with microfinance institutions. I think Mike can talk a little bit more about that later, where products are kind of supported by a local MFI in the field. We also found some issues around building the market for push technologies or technologies that don't really have a built-in demand because they're addressing a need of the consumer that they may not be aware of. So Queen Cook Stoves is a good example of this. Many people, the target market of Queen Cook Stoves may not be aware that indoor air pollution is an issue. So you need to build awareness for the social problem that the product is trying to solve. Moving on to talk a little bit about finance. Finance is, I think, one of the most obvious challenges for any kind of social enterprise. But there's a particular challenge around financing hardware-based enterprises. Oftentimes, financing hardware is more expensive. It requires higher risk tolerance because you're not just taking the risk in the business, but you're taking the risk in the technology. It takes higher due diligence costs, and oftentimes investors don't have the expertise to appropriately do their research on the technology and determine if the technology is sound. And all these kind of nuances create a need for unique financial instruments. And it's also important to recognize that there's a variety of different types of financiers out there, everything from governments to foundations and philanthropy to social impact first investment to more kind of traditional venture capital and then finally to commercial capital in banks. And what we were finding was that a lot of times these entrepreneurs that are developing products in the developing world are spending, you know, 90% of their time running around chasing financing and not enough time actually building their businesses. So we need to find a way to better streamline this financing process and to, you know, share due diligence costs across investors and to build collaborative financing mechanisms to streamline the financing process. I'm aware that I'm running a little bit short on time, so I'll run through these. The talent gap. So I think this is maybe one of the most important challenges that entrepreneurs, invention-based entrepreneurs face. You know, we hear all the time from our partners that getting good talent in social enterprises is one of the biggest barriers to growth. You know, you can place all the financing you want, but if you don't have the adequate management structure in place, that business isn't going to scale. And when you add the invention component, this talent challenge becomes even more complicated because not only do you need the business skill to run the business, but you also need engineering talent. And what we're finding is that in a lot of local universities, there's not an emphasis on entrepreneurship. So a lot of the top engineering talent wants to get jobs in either in the government or major corporations, but they don't see entrepreneurship as a viable career path. So we need to change that and need to work with universities to help build the entrepreneurship component of their engineering programs. There's also not a lot of technical support for invention-based businesses out there. Not a lot of incubators or accelerators specialize in providing technical support to those ventures. And also, if you're an established invention-based enterprise, it's very difficult to recruit and retain qualified engineering talent. A lot of the engineering talent coming out of the universities may be very book smart and may be well suited to work in major corporations, but they lack that certain the on-the-job skill that is required for these small startup invention-based enterprises. Moving on to policy, I won't spend a lot of time here because this is very context-specific. But essentially, there's a lot of policy issues that prevent the growth of small and growing businesses and invention-based businesses in the developing world. And these can kind of be categorized into R&D and commercialization policy, intellectual property rights, and also access to raw materials. A lot of countries are very kind of focused on getting foreign investment, so they make it easier to import finished products rather than industrial inputs. So acquiring the raw materials to grow businesses is very difficult. Finally, we're talking about physical capital gap, and I think Mike's going to talk about this at more length. But basically, in order to build prototypes and refine prototypes, you need to have access to the equipment to actually build those prototypes. And in the developing world, a lot of that equipment isn't necessarily available. And the process of building a prototype in a lab in the United States, shipping it to Kenya, testing it in the market there, finding out something that you need to tweak, and then flying back to your lab in the United States, building another prototype, flying back, can become very expensive and very time-consuming very quickly. So there's really a huge advantage to being able to prototype locally. But oftentimes these entrepreneurs have difficulty in finding the necessary equipment they need to prototype. So in some local ecosystems, we found that this equipment might actually be around, but just not readily available. So it might be in a university, a local corporation might have it, but they're unwilling to provide access to entrepreneurs for a number of reasons. So being able to locate this equipment and forming partnerships to increase access to that equipment can be very productive. And I think Michael definitely talked about this, but there's also a lot of emerging kind of efforts to provide this physical equipment in the form of maker spaces or kind of incubation spaces where entrepreneurs can access the physical capital they need to prototype. So our report came up with several main recommendations. First of all, to map the ecosystem and see what's out there and create access to what's already out there so you don't need to duplicate efforts. Create a community, so having a community of people that are all interested and working to support invention-based entrepreneurship. Engaging the universities, so universities are very important in a variety of sectors, but have been somewhat reluctant to engage in this entrepreneurship or the entrepreneurial ecosystem, so engaging them. Forming partnerships with corporate actors is also important. And finally, I think a lot of the time, a lot of the focus is on financing, but we think that building this ecosystem of support will really unlock financing. So I'd encourage you all to read the report. It's available online at aspeninstitute.org/ANDE, or just Google Impact Inventing. But I will let you go ahead, and I think Mike has some very interesting things to say, and then we can get back to Q&A at the end. So I look forward to your questions, and I think I have my email and our Twitter feed here, so if you have anything, please feel free to shoot me an email. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Paul.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Alex, for that overview. And I think you gave a really good snapshot of the landscape and the ecosystem and the interdisciplinary nature of trying to take inventions to market. You know, the complexity of the market, the finance, the talent, the policy, and the physical capital really shows the complexity of what people are trying to do. And I'd be interested to hear in the question and answer if those same themes were very constant across the locations that you did the workshops, or if there was any significant differences in given local contexts. So now we've got that big picture perspective from the report and the publication that Alex has done and the work that he did around those workshops. What we really wanted to do was really drill down into someone who is actually doing this work on the ground. So we're really lucky to have with us today Mike Han from Sanergy. And for those of you that don't know Sanergy, they're a sanitation based organization working out of Nairobi, Kenya, and they're doing some very interesting work. And as I say, this is an opportunity to hear from people that are actually doing it and to understand what the challenges are and opportunities are from their perspective on the ground. So over to you, Mike. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Alexander. Thanks for having me, E4C and ASME and everyone. Apologize to anyone who is actually in the Santa Clara meeting. These slides will look very familiar. But in any case, Sanergy, we're a sanitation provider in Nairobi, Kenya, focusing on urban sanitation, where we make sanitation accessible, affordable, and hygienic in urban slums for all, forever. That's our little tagline. To go into our business model, we believe that simply providing sanitation isn't enough to create a sustainable solution, and we really believe that the business value chain behind it is going to make it sustainable over the long haul. So in this chart, you can see we build franchised toilets in the slums, and we sell those to micro-entrepreneurs who operate them on a daily basis and charge per use, and they collect all of that revenue from their customers, and we collect the waste from the toilets every day and aggregate the waste at our waste treatment plant and process it into fertilizer, biogas, and other byproducts. So to go into a little bit more detail, we build these toilets out of precast concrete panels, you can see on the left, and on the right you can see a franchise owner, and we collect the waste every day. As probably many of you are aware, urban slums are extremely dense, and access to the toilets is difficult, and oftentimes actually more than 90% of the time is hand collection is necessary. So even the cart can only get so far. So typically we collect from the toilet by hand, take it to the cart. Cart goes to a collection node where the truck can access that and then aggregate it to our processing facility where we convert it on the right into fertilizer. And as a small enterprise, growing enterprise, this process started essentially is a composting process. But as we scale, we've converted to industrial processes that have a much higher turnaround time, much faster turnaround time. And then finally, we have the sale and reuse of the byproduct, which is where we make the money to sustain the business. So give you some perspective on my role in the organization. I lead the product development team and was charged with redesigning the toilet from the ground up. When I joined the company, we had 15 toilets on the ground, and the company was very aware that this toilet design was not going to be scalable. It was essentially a prototype that became the production model out of necessity to get the business going, and over the last couple of years has been sort of bandaged to the point where it works decently well, but there's a lot of loss and a lot of efficiency to be gained from a better design. And this picture you can see is a sort of timeline of the what we call squat plate development, and going from the earliest on the left to the new on the right. So we use a urine-diverting dry toilet, which separates the urine from the waste, from the solid waste, at the source separating. And so a lot of the development centered around the end user aspect, the customer aspect, and their perceptions of quality of our toilet, because that's where we are, that's our competitive edge in the marketplace, in the urban sanitation marketplace. We're not the first to have charge per use toilets. We're not the first to provide toilets throughout the slums. That's not new. Our value add is a very high quality experience for the customers, clean, hygienic, guaranteed every time. Before I go into that, I want to talk a little bit about this pyramid triangle scheme that I constantly think about in product development, where we want it all. We want it to be a fast process. We want it to be high quality, and we want it to be low cost. But in actuality, we can't have all of those at the same time. So I think this is especially important in small growing enterprise where we really don't have enough money to make things happen fast and at high quality. And so we're sort of driven into this area of doing it more cheaply and taking a much longer time because we still need to maintain that high quality of the final product. So I just want to put this out there. So I'm going to sort of frame my discussion. So going into detail, this is the old toilet design. The squat plate is mounted on a piece of plywood, which is epoxy painted, and the floor is concrete, which has also been epoxy painted. And you can see the waste containers in the bottom there. The problem with this, and actually the picture on the right is actually wrong. The blue container at the bottom is actually a jerry can, not a barrel. Not actually sure why that's in there. But in any case, there's a lot of room for error here. There's the tolerances are super wide. Containers can get misaligned. The squat plate can feel unstable after a while of washing. You can imagine plywood absorbing cleaning liquids and actually cleaning liquids from cleaning the floor going down into this this hole in the ground, which we call a retaining box. Which Sanergy staff is responsible for. So in the franchise agreement, where Sanergy is responsible for everything below grade and the owner is responsible for everything above the floor, maintaining cleanliness, providing toilet paper, sawdust, hand washing station with soap, making sure the mirror's intact on the door, the coat hook operates, all of those things. And if they don't, then coming to us for repairs. But so this creates a huge problem for our waste collection staff, or the standard, or the Fresh Life frontline, as we call them, where they'll arrive to a toilet that has had a problem, a misalignment or a spillage or cleaning liquids have gone down, and they're actually responsible for cleaning that up. So it's a huge time loss, and it creates this really negative environment or relationship between our franchisees and our waste collectors, and that's a really valuable relationship to us, because it's a day-to-day relationship, and if they're unhappy together, then it creates much bigger problems down the road. So quickly go through some design research, ergonomic research, sampling a number of people to understand positions and ergonomics, and most of the design, as you can imagine, is the squat plate is based around women, because men are very simple to design for. But we were finding that women were actually moving between urination and defecation, and the reason for that was that they are aiming for the front of the squat plate. And I apologize for anybody who's sort of at lunch now or whatever. I'm used to talking about all this quite candidly. So that became a real design driver for our squat plate, and making it deep, splash resistant, or anti-splash, and also making it as deep as possible to prevent that splash. So prototyping this in Kenya, there was a video here, but I'll snapshot the process. Built a prototype out of clay, did a plaster casting from that clay, and then made a fiberglass functional prototype from that plaster, using the plaster as a mold. And that was a very available, I say very available, it took me weeks to find the right clay and the right plaster, what you get out of it is a prototype that works really well for as a prototype and creating a functional prototype that you can actually test in the toilet and get exit interviews and talk to people about its function. But at a certain point, this doesn't really work for manufacturing. So after a certain amount of that, we arrived at, this is what we wanted. We can draw it in a computer. We need the toilet to be this. Now, this is really hard to do in Nairobi if you're talking about generating the tooling for these precast panels, the squat plate, which is made from plastic, and the retaining box that goes in the ground, which is a roto-molded part. And so it sort of forced us to bring that process back to the U.S. Because I have personal connections here that was able to leverage those, and access to technology is much easier, and also being able to trust suppliers with your design in terms of knowing that they'll do a decent high quality job. So here you can see the new retaining box container configuration that eliminates putting the containers in wrong. It eliminates the movement of the containers. Misalignment becomes impossible. But it also creates it's hard to see in the picture, but it also creates a lip above the floor where a sort of water dam, if you will. So when you're washing the floor, the water can't go down inside this box. But even if it did, it's plastic and it's easier to clean. And then, of course, the precast tile flooring instead of epoxy paint. So here's a snapshot of the process that I need to go through in terms of building the tooling for the squat plate. And reminder that to go back to that triangle, we're doing this as cheaply as possible, but trying to maintain a high quality. And so typically, if we had a lot of money, I would have sent this CAD file to a mold or a tooling producer, and they would have made this out of an aluminum block and sent it to a high-end vacuum forming shop. Instead, we made it on a shop bought out of MDF, resin, fiberglass, and took it to a kayak manufacturer out here in Washington State that is willing to do these sort of odd jobs. But here's the final product. And I'll welcome any questions in terms of that. Enter Gearbox. Gearbox is a prototyping facility that Sanergy, iHub, Brick, and others are starting out of necessity in Nairobi. And so I tell the Sanergy story as an intersection to this, and I say prototyping facility because it's not a makerspace, as we tend to think of makerspaces. It's really focused on bringing products to market and creating the ecosystem or culture in the space to do that, to create and backing investment, but also be able to do a small batch production of prototypes and first run to test the market at a decent scale. So the gearbox will incorporate a lot of tools: wood shop, metal shop, modeling shop, electronics lab, and a fab lab, we're calling it, which is the larger, higher-end tools for 5-axis CNCs, 3-axis mills, for actually doing fabrication jobs for local industry, I believe is a large revenue stream that is potential for this. So in here's what it might look like. This is actually not the space, but a number of mills. And so it also incorporates a very high level of training to get our local entrepreneurs making high quality products right from the beginning, and understanding the time and resource that that requires. I think there's a bit of naivete on entrepreneurs, engineers slash entrepreneurs, in the amount of time and energy and craftsmanship that it takes to bring even a simple prototype to market. And this is an example of an industry player in Nairobi Containers who's a roto-molder, and they're excited about generating new products and increasing their catalog. But to do so, they've historically gone to India to relatives, and there are personal connections in India that the design shop's over there, the tooling shop is over there, and having molds shipped back to them. And so it's a very long, time-intensive process for them to generate new products. And oftentimes it results in a sort of attitude of, oh, well, it's good enough, or we'll just take whatever molds you have and not really provide a product that's specific to the market needs. And so they're very excited about being able to prototype things and generate tooling locally in Nairobi. Here's a quick idea of what the space might look like in terms of layout. We're looking for 25,000 square feet to start with, and going from there. And just so you know, we're always looking for funders and in-kind support, equipment being a major area for support that we're looking for currently. But we're also looking for the thought leaders and professional instructors, leaders, and mentorship to do sort of residency programs. And this program is not yet defined, but if you're interested, definitely give me a shout, send me an email. So I guess with that, I'll open up to questions, send it back to you, Paul, and we'll go from there.
Excellent, Mike. Thanks very much for that. And I think, you know, with the experience of Synergy on the ground, and specifically the experience of a product developer trying to prototype with a view to scale on the ground, that complements very nicely with the general themes and the overview that Alex presented to us earlier about the complexity and the intricacies of getting products to market in an effective and scalable way so they meet users' needs. Now, we'll go into a question and answer session for this portion. We've got about 7 minutes to do that. So if you have any questions, please enter them into the question and answer tab of your of the portal. I've got a few that I would like to start with, and then as extra ones come in, I'll put those away, and I'll ask from those. So, Alex, I alluded to this earlier. Maybe you could talk a little bit about the themes that you saw across invention-based entrepreneurs and in terms of the ecosystem, the market, the finance, the talent, the policy, and the physical gap. Was that constant across all the locations in the workshop? And, you know, how much was global and how much was locally specific?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. I think the challenges faced by invention-based entrepreneurs are somewhat consistent around the world, but I think the way that we address those problems needs to be very sensitive of the local context. So, for example, I think one of the big differences that we saw was the country's experience kind of supporting the growth of technology-based ventures, whether they be impact-focused or not. So, for example, Brazil has a really great history of technology incubation. They have a huge and thriving kind of technology venture space, whereas Kenya, on the other hand, doesn't have that. So, you know, in our roundtable in Brazil, we encourage participants to think about tangible actions that they could take to improve their local ecosystem. So the participants in Brazil came up with this kind of theoretical project where they could partner with local technology incubators. Fundação Certi was the one they were talking about and who was attending the roundtable. And they're a really well-respected and well-established technology incubator, but they don't focus on social impact technologies. So partnering that institution with kind of the ANDE incubators in country that have the experience incubating social ventures can be a really productive partnership. So we're talking about creating like a track in their incubation program that would help incubate social ventures. Whereas, you know, if you're in Kenya, you don't have that expertise to leverage. So you really have to think about how to build from the ground up. But I would say overall, it's very important to look at the local context, and before designing any kind of intervention, think about what resources are already there that you can leverage before you try to reinvent the wheel and start all over again from scratch.
Excellent. Thank you. And you ask one question and many come in, so keep them coming in. There's questions coming across, of which we should have time to answer to most of them. One for you, Mike, which is an interesting one. You know, obviously, at the moment, you're managing to do in this development and manufacturing internationally and getting that to market in that way. What's Synergy's strategy for transferring that development locally and upskilling your local talent to be able to do that closer to the customer?
I think this question might, you know, be geared more towards Gearbox, because Synergy is ideally we wouldn't be doing all of these things ourselves. We would be working in an environment where we can outsource aspects of the development of these hardware products. So the strategy is really to get Gearbox run up and running and develop the training curriculum and success stories to create a culture of high level manufacturing skills and design training. We've actually had a very difficult time finding local employees for the product development department at Synergy, and we're really sort of looking to Gearbox to develop the culture increase the amount of people that are wanting to do this kind of work. I think Alex alluded to this earlier when he was talking about engineers not really either knowing or wanting to participate in this space because of sort of access to corporate, you know, good paying corporate jobs. And frankly, this work is quite a, you know, this is very difficult because we're sort of demanding that everyone do everything because we're on such a bootstrap budget that we're really looking for talent that is across disciplines. And that is something that's hard to find locally. And it's not something that's being sort of emphasized from the university perspective. I'm not sure I answered the question, but
Paul, can I take a shot at that as well?
Please do, Alex.
So yeah, I think there's, you know, there's a short-term solution, there's a long-term solution. I think in the short-term, mentoring is a really important kind of vehicle that we need to explore and we need to do better. I think ASME is well suited to play in this place because they have a huge network of engineering talent that at a very senior level that I think it would be great to be able to tap into and provide some of these small and growing businesses with access to that sort of mentorship and that sort of advice. A lot of these entrepreneurs don't have any sort of board level or mentorship level support to bounce ideas off of or to get mentoring from. So increasing access to that is a very important short-term solution. But we also have to address this at the systemic level, and that's through the university system. I think we really need to increase the university's awareness of what talents these kind of enterprises need. So whether that's through internship programs or partnerships with local incubators or accelerators, I think we need to identify the kind of the disruptors in these university systems and work with them through partnerships to help them understand the needs of these small invention-based enterprises.
Yeah, thanks, Alex. And I think that's a good point in terms of the different stages of this, the short term and the long term. And, you know, to paraphrase your answer, Mike, I mean, I think, you know, given that it was becoming such a detriment to your business, that it's really the incentive that has led you to participate in the Gearbox initiative and to really try and build that out for the future, not only for Synergy, but other locally local entrepreneurs that are interested in this space. So, you know, I think you've already taken your first step along that strategy, but, you know, obviously it takes time to get you where you need to be. Unfortunately, we've run out of time, but if you submit a question through the question and answer tab on the webinar, we'll make sure that we get an answer back to you on the specific points. I think a number of the questions that came across were related to the interaction between the different elements of this, and I think that's something, I'm a social scientist by training, and that interdisciplinary nature of trying to take these products to market I think is very important. So, you know, I think that was the theme a lot of that came through a number of the questions, specifically on the local policy and how the local policy provides the right environment or the wrong environment for the ability to do some of these ventures effectively and to make them competitive in the local market. So just to say two things before we leave. Firstly, I'd just like to announce that hopefully there are some there's the ability to provide some support in this with the launching of something that's called the ASME Innovation Showcase. And for more information on that, please go to go.asme.org/iShow. There's going to be over $500,000 worth of prizes in cash and engineering support, specifically for hardware based social ventures. So take a look at that if you've got an idea and you want to take it to market. And lastly, for those that have participated on the webinar today, you have your professional development code, which you can enter to get an hour's worth of time. And just to remind you that if you have any questions or you have any comments or you'd like to suggest new themes or potential topics for webinars, please email us at webinars@engineeringforchange.org. And before we leave today, just again to say a really big thank you to our presenters, Alex Pan from ANDE and Mike Han from Synergy. Thanks so much for your time, really enlightening and engaging discussions. So thank you and take care.